My name is Chris, and when I was 19 years old, I was diagnosed with a pituitary tumor that almost killed me. Long story short.
Tonight, the major news on boosters for younger teens as COVID surges across the country. The FDA authorizing boosters for children ages 12 to 15 as millions return to school after the holiday break. Parents on edge waiting hours in line to get kids tested. Child hospitalization soaring. Dr. Jaw is here answering your questions. Also tonight, the major winter storm hitting the East Coast. Thousands of flights canceled, just as many are returning home for the holidays. Cars stranded on the highway. Heavy snow shutting down Washington, D.C. President Biden stuck on Air Force One for nearly 30 minutes. We're tracking it all. Just in, the verdict in the Elizabeth Holmes trial after the jury said it was deadlocked on multiple counts. The desperate search for the missing after that Colorado wildfire destroyed nearly 1,000 homes. Why investigators are focusing on this piece of video. AT&T and Verizon rejecting a plea to delay their 5G launch. Why airlines have big concerns.
This is NBC Nightly News with Lester Holt.
Good evening. No image tells us more about the state we're in with COVID right now more clearly than the latest map of places with community transmission, places where the virus is spreading locally. They're highlighted in red, and yes, it is the entire country. While it appears there is no outrunning this virus this evening, there are new efforts to keep pace. The FDA okaying boosters for kids 12 to 15, also shortening the booster wait time for many others. As we return from holiday breaks, it feels like the world is on rewind. Schools wrestling once more with how to safely teach our children, while travelers struggle to get home in the face of COVID-related flight delays, their burden made worse by a major eastern snowstorm. We have it all covered tonight, starting with Stephanie Goss.
With COVID cases soaring to record levels, an uneasy return to school. Even though more vaccine protection could soon be available. Today, the FDA authorized the Pfizer booster for children ages 12 to 15, at least 5 months after completing their initial vaccination. Children ages 5 to 11 with compromised immune systems could be eligible for third doses. The CDC is expected to sign off on the changes Wednesday. While schools facing the highly contagious but apparently less severe Omicron variant are instituting a patchwork of policies to get kids back in classrooms safely. Cleveland and Atlanta schools are remote for the week. Other places delayed a return to class so children could be tested. In New York City, school doors swung open this morning, officials urging families to get their children tested.
We're not in a good place. I'm going to be really honest with you. This is the winter surge we predicted.
The New York governor placing an emphasis on keeping schools open.
The question is, how do parents get these very rare test kits that you always see the lines for? We're going to put them in your hands. We're going to put them in the kids' backpacks.
But they aren't there yet. Alina Konkin waited 2 hours to get her 11-year-old tested.
There should be a more efficient and streamlined process.
It's a similar story nationwide. Rapid tests are hard to find in stores. People are sitting for hours in their cars for PCR tests. The results sometimes taking days. As concerns grow over record numbers of children being admitted to the hospital with COVID. But at least some of those cases are children being treated for other conditions who happen to test positive for the virus. It's unclear if the number of severe COVID cases in children is on the rise.
What we're going to need to do is make sure that those children who can be vaccinated are vaccinated, that children wear masks while they're in school to protect themselves and to protect each other.
The CDC is also taking another look at its controversial guidance to decrease quarantine from 10 to 5 days without a negative test.
Testing could be a part of that, and I think we're going to be hearing more about that in the next day or so from the CDC.
Potentially adding demand for tests that are already tough to get your hands on.
And 70 for kids who have returned to the classroom. What's being done to prevent outbreaks?
Well, Lester, here in New York, when one or more students in the same class test positive for COVID, instead of quarantining the whole class, they're going to send them home with rapid tests, and anyone who tests negative can come back in the next day.
That's in New York tonight. Thank you. Just a short time ago, I spoke with Dr. Ashish Jha, dean of the Brown University School of Public Health. I asked him if he thinks we're ultimately all going to be infected with this Omicron variant.
I don't think we're all going to be infected. Many Americans are. But there's a lot we can do to protect ourselves, and My hope is that a vast majority of Americans don't end up getting infected from this variant.
Is Omicron going to push Delta out of the picture, and would that be a good thing?
We don't know. We did see it push Delta out in South Africa. In the UK, the data is not totally clear yet. It looks like it's suppressing Delta. If it ends up pushing Delta out, it would be terrific, because all the data so far suggests that Omicron is a milder version. And obviously, if we're going to have a virus circulating around, I'd rather have a milder version circulating around.
And is there anything here that suggests that Omicron might be the beginning of the end?
Well, I sure hope so. I mean, I do think a lot of Americans are going to end up getting infected. Now, obviously, we have a good chunk of Americans also vaccinated. That means if there are future variants, that they will impact us less, because we have so much immunity in our population. And that's how a pandemic comes to an end, and that's what I'm hoping we're looking forward to.
It's a mixed bag of how well we have learned lessons in all this, the testing crisis that we're witnessing. Do you think that we will learn that lesson in case of the next variant?
I sure hope so. I remember back in March of 2020 saying we need a lot more testing than we have. And here we are in January of 2022, and I'm still saying we need a lot more tests. I think the administration has seen the testing crisis, and hopefully will get its act together on making testing widely available for Americans. That's going to be a key part of managing this pandemic for months and really years to come.
Our thanks to Dr. Jha. As we've seen, this COVID explosion has hit the airlines hard, and today so did that big winter storm that caused more mass cancellations and frustration for travelers, many still trying to get home. Here's Tom Costello.
I made my first experimental models to provide myself with means to listen to music.
Since 1946.
Adding more misery to weary and stranded travelers coming back from the holidays, a massive storm stretching from the deep south, Florida and Alabama, to the nation's capital in the bullseye today. Hit with up to a foot of snow. Air Force One returning to Joint Base Andrews in virtual whiteout conditions. The president emerging from the plane in a blinding snowstorm. In the I-95 corridor, thousands of cars stranded and stuck. Accidents and power outages. Amtrak also affected. At the center of the bullseye, Reagan National Airport. Topping the list of most affected airports today, 84% of departures canceled.
I've been here since 7 o'clock. I've been delayed 3 times and then canceled.
Today's storm, the latest blow to airlines and hundreds of thousands of holiday passengers. Since Christmas Eve, more than 18,000 flights canceled. Hit hard by airline and TSA staffers calling out sick with COVID. Then a series of winter storms. Today alone, 3,000 flights canceled.
Here at Reagan Airport, the snow coming down so heavily they had to close the main runway for plowing at 8 a.m.
Thousands of passengers stuck.
I'm trying to fly back home. I've been out since 3 in the morning this morning, and my flight got changed twice.
The cancellations rippling across the country from Chicago O'Hare to Fort Lauderdale, where Andrea Lynn and her kids have been trying to get to Detroit since Friday.
We have to stay an extra couple days, and hotels are outrageous on New Year's Eve. So we were kind of trapped.
While it truly has been a perfect series of storms for the airlines, consumer advocates say the airlines also bear some blame.
The airline industry has been understaffed for months, even before this latest surge with COVID going back to the summer.
So Tom, how are things looking for tomorrow air travel-wise?
So far, 400 flights canceled for tomorrow. That will likely grow through the night and through tomorrow, but hopefully that tomorrow gives them the opportunity to recover and start to get people on their way, Lester.
That would be great. All right, Tom, thanks. There is some breaking news in the trial of Theranos founder Elizabeth Holmes. The verdict coming in just moments ago after the jury told the judge it was deadlocked on multiple counts. We get more now from Aaron McLaughlin.
Elizabeth Holmes, once celebrated as an entrepreneur set to revolutionize medical testing, tonight leaves a federal courtroom a convicted felon. A jury found the 37-year-old guilty of 4 counts of federal fraud, acquitting her of 4 others while deadlocking on the 3 remaining charges. After the prosecution alleged she conned investors and patients into believing her blood testing startup Theranos could perform hundreds of diagnostic tests with just the prick of a finger.
It's a big deal for Silicon Valley, because if fake it till you make it, I don't think they're going to be living by that anymore.
Ruling some of the world's most powerful to invest millions of dollars. This well as patients who testified they received faulty test results.
It was witness after witness telling us, corroborating the same statements and misrepresentations that she made.
The closely watched trial, the subject of podcasts, books, and an upcoming series, lasted for more than 3 months. Prosecution of repeatedly alleging, out of time and out of money, Elizabeth Holmes decided to lie. She chose fraud over business failure. She chose to be dishonest. The prosecutor told the jury that choice was not only callous, it was criminal. During the trial, Holmes took the stand. She acknowledged there were some things she wished she'd done differently, while arguing her discussions with investors focused on the future. They weren't interested in today or tomorrow or next month, she said. They were interested in what kind of change we could make. Tonight, the woman was hailed as the next Steve Jobs. This is jail time. Holmes was stoic as the verdict was read out. She hugged her parents before leaving the courtroom. She faces up to 20 years in prison for each guilty count. Lester?
Aaron, thank you. In just 60 seconds, a desperate search in Colorado, days after that devastating fire, and 1 year after January 6th, we're looking at how some there that day are now focusing their efforts closer to home. In Colorado, a desperate search goes on tonight for people who might have become caught in that devastating fire that swept through neighborhoods near Boulder. Emily McKenna has the latest.
Tonight, an urgent search for two people missing since the Marshall Fire swallowed entire neighborhoods in Colorado. But officials fear a grim outcome. Their homes, now ash.
We are actively working at two scenes. It is very, very difficult work.
The monstrous Marshall Fire burned into the memories of residents. Flames engulfed the length of football fields within seconds, some barely escaping the hellscape. Now face a painful recovery ahead.
It's killing me. Then we can't be there for him.
Devin Saker's father in the hospital after family saw him driving a neighbor out of the burn zone. To put himself at risk to help someone else, does this sound characteristic of your dad?
Very much so. If he sees somebody, he needs help.
The aftermath, apocalyptic. Nearly 1,000 homes reduced to rubble. Another 100 damaged.
There isn't going to be a kid that doesn't know someone who's lost everything.
The sheriff has pointed to the area near Marshall Road and Highway 93 as a possible origin of the devastating fire that consumed more than 6,000 acres. Numerous witnesses first spotting flames at a shed near there, quickly picked up by hurricane-force winds.
In the video, the smoke was very light, and then it just progressed so fast.
Investigators say it's too early to tell whether the shed was the exact ignition point. Sheriff's deputies executing a search warrant over the weekend, but won't say where.
We haven't eliminated or honed in on any one specific thing. It's an open investigation.
While the snow helped nearly extinguish the Marshall Fire, it's now a challenge for investigators who are trying to uncover evidence around the cause of the blaze. And Lester, there's more snow on the way.
Also tonight, new subpoenas have been issued for Ivanka Trump and Donald Trump Jr. The representative, Letitia James, wants their testimony and documents as part of her civil tax fraud investigation into the Trump Organization. James also wants to depose former President Trump. Trump has blasted the investigation by the Democratic Attorney General as politically motivated. And this week marks 1 year since a mob of Trump supporters stormed the U.S. Capitol. In the time since the January 6th riot, domestic extremists have shifted strategies. Randy Zabrosny explains how in our series, State of Extremism.
January 6th, 2021. Crowds marched to the U.S. Capitol building. Throngs of people grew into thousands. Denise Aguilar posted to social media that day, saying she was there.
The revolution's here, guys. We stormed the Capitol, and patriots broke open the doors.
Aguilar later said she never breached the building nor participated in violence. And since then, she's taken her fight back home.
It's all about local legislation, your local school district, your city council board of supervisors. So it kicked off as a national movement that now parents are realizing we need to start coming to the local government.
Her shift is part of a broader trend, according to Jared Holt, who studies domestic extremism at the nonpartisan movement, the Atlantic Council.
Domestic extremism is really like a fluid that matches the container that is going to be in a different moment.
In a new report, Holt says that following backlash and hundreds of arrests connected to the attack on the Capitol, far-right activists have shifted their focus from national politics to local.
A lot of the adaptations that we've seen came in the form of decentralizing these national movements.
What are these extremists all talking about at the local level? What is the content?
A lot of them are taking it upon themselves to re-engage in the broader conservative culture war.
We are here to protect the children of our community.
For Aguilar, who we met outside a local school board meeting in California, is opposition to mandates.
We figured out that going to the Capitol and working that particular piece doesn't do anything because these legislators have already made up their minds.
She is the founder of a group called Momalitia and says her activism is peaceful.
Do we look violent to you? Do we look like we're trying to storm any place? Have I ever done anything violent in the Capitol? Absolutely not.
Like many who share her goals, Aguilar uses alternative social media platforms like Telegram to organize and strategize.
This is what they're doing at the school board meetings.
Those go local tactics also being embraced by prominent white nationalists.
This is the right approach. Going to the school board meetings, going out to protest.
But the Proud Boys responding, taking to the streets of towns in Long Island and North Carolina to protest public health measures.
Extremist groups have always seen the culture war as a place that has enough anger and division already that it can be fruitful for them.
Are we in a better place now than we were on January 5th of last year?
I do think there have been some reassuring signs, but the undercurrents and the conditions that, you know, led to January 6th, this popularization of conspiracy theories, of extreme sentiments and ideologies, is maybe more pernicious than it was last year.
And with the focus off the nation's capital for now, the impact of that extremism can be felt anywhere. Brandi Zadrozny, NBC News, Washington.
Up next, the battle over 5G, the new warning that it could cause even more air travel delays days from now.
Step 2. Enjoy quality time with quality ingredients. Step 3. Make an incredible meal you can't wait to share.
Expand your definition of healthy living. Visit blueapron.com loves 110 to get $110 off.
Airline and transportation officials are warning of even more possible widespread disruptions after Verizon and AT&T rejected requests to delay this week's start of 5G cellular service. Airlines say the signals could interfere with a plane's electronics. Here's Kerry Sanders.
Tonight, it's an unknown. When AT&T and Verizon's 5G phone towers go live on Wednesday, will those signals interfere with a critical instrument in a plane's cockpit? Called a radio altimeter, which tells pilots the distance the plane is from the ground, crucial during landings, especially in bad weather. The Secretary of Transportation warning if 5G goes live Wednesday, it will result in widespread and unacceptable disruptions as airplanes divert to other cities or flights are canceled. But both AT&T and Verizon say they plan to throw the switch Wednesday, writing to the FAA, 5G and aviation already coexist in nearly 40 other countries, though for the next 6 months, they would agree to fade or decrease 5G signals around some airports to give the FAA and plane manufacturers time to determine if interference is simply theoretical or indeed real.
They're testing the airplanes about as rapidly as they can. All we need to do is give them time to find out which devices are susceptible.
If you have 5G on your phone, that is not the signal that's in question. Plus, engineers say it's not the phone that causes the potential problem, it's the towers. Lester?
A lot of folks holding their breath on this. Kerry, thank you. That's Nightly News for this Monday. Thank you for watching, everyone. I'm Lester Holt. Please take care of yourself and each other. Good night. Thanks for watching our YouTube channel. Follow today's top stories and breaking news by downloading the NBC News app.
Hey, welcome to Beyond the Scenes. This is the podcast that goes above and beyond the topics that you see every night on The Daily Show with Trevor Noah on Comedy Central. Now, this week marks the one-year anniversary. I don't even like the word anniversary because I don't want to keep remembering this thing. But the January 6th uprising that went down at the Capitol, the insurrection, a bunch of Trump supporters went there and lost their damn minds and violently tried to stop the certification of electoral votes by storming the Capitol. Even to say it aloud, it's surreal. So we have two people with us on the program today to help us break this down. The first gentleman. He's an Emmy-nominated Daily Show contributor. He was there at the Capitol, and he's always there all the time, mixing it up with the Trump supporters. And if anyone that is not a fan of his activities, it is his wife and child. He is Jordan Klepper. Yes.
I was there with my Emmy nomination